Hello friends, greetings from School of Open Learning. I, Renu Ghosh from Department of Commerce, Rajdhani College, welcome you all to the online video presentation. This video is an introduction to BCom Honours CBCS course Business Laws. In this video, I will provide an overview of the following. First, subject, business laws, CBCS framework and objective. Second, relevance of business laws. Third, syllabus of business laws and brief description of it. Fourth, list of references suggested by university for the subject. And last, course outcomes, weightage of the paper and its duration of examination. Dear friends, you will be happy to know that CBCS system of Delhi University has been introduced in School of Open Learning from current academic session 2019-20. Before this, School of Open Learning followed annual system of examination. Under CBCS system, each academic year is divided into two semesters. So, in total, there would be six semesters. The examination will take place at the end of each semester. The paper of business laws is in semester 1. The main objective of this paper is to impart basic knowledge of the important business laws relevant for the conduct of general business activities in physical and virtual spaces along with relevant case laws. Now, I will tell you why is it important to study the paper of business laws and how the knowledge of this course helps us in doing business activities effectively. It is common knowledge that ignorance of law is no excuse. In other words, ignorance of law cannot be made an excuse for committing the breach of law. I give you an example. Suppose I jump a red light and traffic policeman asked me to pay the challan. I cannot refuse to pay the challan just by saying that I do not know that jumping the red light is a violation of traffic rule. That is why it is generally common and accepted fact that every person is presumed to know the law. The knowledge of law is very important for any responsible citizen. The knowledge of law provides an edge in performing the daily activities with a thoughtful and judicious manner. Just as there are laws that apply to people, similarly, there are laws that apply to business. We all know that a business has separate legal entity and it can do most things that a person can do. A business can buy and sell property, sue and be sued, enter into contracts, hire and fire employees, and even commit crimes. The term business law may be defined as that branch of law which comprises laws concerning trade, industry, and commerce. It is ever-growing branch of law with the changing circumstance of trade and business. With the changing environment and increased complexities of modern business, the scope of business law has enormously widened to include laws relating to contract, sale of goods, forms of carrying business, information technology, etc. Therefore, it is important for new entrepreneurs, business managers, and other professionals to have a basic understanding of business laws so that they can take better decisions. For example, you started your own new venture and you go out in the market to buy building for your business. Suppose on the basis of faith, you paid the whole consideration in advance. And later on, when you ask the seller to deliver property, he refuses to do so. In this case, you cannot sue the seller in court as there is lack of valid contract between you and the seller. In this case, the law does not recognize faith. There are certain essential elements of a contract which must be there to make it valid and enforceable. The basic objective of this paper is not to make you expert, but to make you aware of the many legal issues that arise in the day-to-day operations of any business. Being aware of these potential issues, we can prevent ourselves from falling into any kind of trap. The syllabus of business laws comprises of 5 units. Unit 1 covers the provisions relating to Indian Contract Act 1872. Unit 2 is related to the special contracts. Unit 3 is the sale of Goods Act 1930. Unit 4, the Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008. And the last unit of the syllabus covers provisions relating to the Information Technology Act 2000. Unit 1 covers the Indian Contract Act 1872. The Indian Contract Act 1872 came into force on 1st day of September 1872. The Indian Contract Act is the foundation upon which the superstructure of modern business is built. It is commonly accepted fact that in business transactions, quite often promises are made at one time and the performance of such promise follows later. Suppose, in such a situation, if either of the parties were free to go back on its promise without any liability and responsibility, think what would happen. There would be endless complexities. And believe me, it would be impossible to carry on business. Hence, the law of contract was enacted. It lays down the legal rules relating to promises, their formation, their performance, and their enforceability. Understanding of business law is important, not only for businessmen. It is important for general people also, because we enter into number of contracts in our day-to-day life. I give you another example. When we give our clothes for dry cleaning, it is a contract between us and dry cleaner. Both the parties are liable to perform their obligations. Here, dry cleaner is to perform his function by cleaning the clothes and deliver it on time. And the performance of customer is to pay for seller's performance. If any party fails to fulfill their obligation, then the other party has the right to enforce that contract in court and sue the defaulting party. Unit 1 of the syllabus covers meaning, characteristics, and kinds of contracts. In this unit, we will also learn various essential elements of a contract to make it valid and enforceable in court of law. For example, offer and acceptance, consideration means price paid, contractual capacity, free consent, legality of object, etc. Discharge of contract, including breach of contract and its remedies, is covered in this unit. Sections 1 to 75 covers general principles of the law of contract. According to Section 2, Subsection H of the Indian Contract Act, an agreement enforceable by law is a contract. A contract, therefore, is an agreement that contains all essential elements to make it enforceable by law. Essential elements of a valid contract are, first, offer and acceptance. There must be lawful offer and lawful acceptance of the offer, thus resulting in agreement. Second, intention to create legal relations. While entering into agreement, the intention among the parties should be to create legal relations. For example, Mr. X promises his wife to get her a sari if she will sing a song. His wife sings a song, but he did not bring sari for her. His wife cannot sue him in court of law because there is lack of intention to create legal relations among the parties. Third, lawful consideration. Consideration is the price paid by one party for the promise. An agreement is legally enforceable only when each of the parties to it gives something and gets something. Fourth, capacity of parties. The parties to an agreement must be competent, means capable to contract. Free consent. Free consent of all the parties to an agreement is another essential element of a valid contract. Consent means all the parties should agree upon same thing in the same sense. Next, lawful object. The object for which the contract is entered must be lawful. Writing and registration. According to Indian Contract Act, a contract can be oral or in writing. But in certain special cases, it must be in writing or even registered to make it valid. Certainty. The agreements, meaning of which is not certain, is void. For example, Mr. X offers Mr. Y to buy his car for rupees 1 lakh. And the offer is accepted by Mr. Y. When this offer was made, Mr. Y had two cars. One is Alto and other one was Swift Desire. Mr. X had thought of buying the Swift. But Mr. Y thought that Mr. X has offered to buy Alto. The model of the car was never discussed while transacting. At the time of delivery, this uncertainty about model of car made the agreement void. Next is the possibility of performance. An agreement to do impossible act is void. And last, not expressly declared void. The agreement must not have been expressly declared void under the Act. Unit 1 highlights the general principles of law of contract contained in sections 1 to 75. However, the law of contract has some special type of contract like quasi contract, contract of indemnity and guarantee, contract of bailment and pledge, and contract of agency. Unit 2 is related to special contracts contained in Indian Contract Act 1872. These special contracts are required to fulfill all the essential elements of a valid contract. Additionally, these special contracts are governed by a number of unique provisions. Sections 68 to 72 of the Indian Contract Act deals with quasi-contractual obligations. The provisions relating to contract of indemnity and guarantee are covered in sections 124 to 147. Sections 148 to 181 are related to contract of bailment and pledge. Contract of agency is related to sections 182 to 238 of Indian Contract Act. Now, I will briefly discuss various terms used under this unit. Quasi-contract is the result of an agreement enforceable by law. What happens in certain cases? There is no offer, no acceptance, no consent, but still contract is imposed by law. Such obligations which are imposed by law are referred to as quasi-contracts. A contract of indemnity is a contract by which one party promises to save the other from the loss caused to him by his conduct or by the conduct of a third party. A contract of guarantee is contract to perform the promise or discharge the liability of a third person in case of his default. Bailment. A bailment is the delivery of goods by one person to another for some purpose. Pledge. The bailment of goods as security for payment of a debt is called pledge. Agency. The contract which creates the relation of principal and agent among the parties is called contract of agency.